Would you hear a wild tale of adventure, of a hero who tackled the sea, of a Superman swimming the ocean? Then hark, while I talk about me. From invasion forts over the channel, the Nazis had sworn to attack, and no volunteers this side had offered to swim out and push them all back. There was great consternation in England. Dart players neglected their beer. And Alvar Liddell said to Belfridge, "This ain't half a muck-up this year." Then up spoke the brave workhouse master. I was spending the summer with him. He said, "I'll give 2 Christmas puddings to anyone here who can swim." Now, in swimming baths all round the country, I was noted for daring and strength. I frequently dived in the deep end and thought nothing of swimming a length. So up I arose in a moment. I said, "I can swim, I believe, though it isn't your puddings I'm after, as I told you last Christmas Eve. If the Huns should come over the channel, from Grisnes to Dover, that is, for the honour and glory of England, I'll swim from Dover to Grisnes." As soon as my words were made public, the newspapers gathered around and offered to pay me a pension if I lost both my legs and got drowned. I borrowed a tug from the Navy to swim in the shelter a lee, and the BBC lent me a wavelength, and Evelyn Lay lent me the sea. I entered the water at daybreak and stood there admiring the dawn, with the wavelets caressing my anklets like the lady in September morn. My girl tied a mascot around me, and the tears to my eyes gently stole. 'Twas some Guinness cork she had collected and stitched to an old camisole. At last I was in, I was swimming with a powerful overarm stroke, when the men on the tug saw with horror that the rope I was tied to had broke. Then down came the fog, thick as treacle, alone on that desolate sea. A voice shouted, "Help, I am drowning." I listened and found it was me. They circled around till they found me, hauled me aboard like a sack, tied a new tow rope around me, smacked me and then threw me back. 'Twas at daybreak or just a bit later that I realized all wasn't right, for the tow rope was trailing behind me and the noose round my waist getting tight. One hasty glance over my shoulder, I saw in a flash what was wrong. The captain had switched off his engine. I was towing the tugboat along. On and on through the darkness I paddled, till I knew I was very near in, by the way I kept bumping the bottom and hitting the stones with my chin. Was it Grisnes I'd reached? No, it wasn't. The treacherous tide in its track had carried me up to Kew Gardens, and I had to walk all the way back.
All right, kiddies, just one more story and then off to bed you must go. Ready? I'll tell of King Henry II and the story of how he got fond of one of his customer's daughters, a girl called the Fair Rosamund. 'Twas a lovely romance while it lasted. The course of true love ran serene, till some nosy parkering varlet started carrying tales to the Queen. The Queen was at first incredulous. She said, "What a tale to invent. The king wouldn't stoop to such baseness, at any rate not during Lent." But one morning she picked up a doublet that he'd dropped on his bedroom settee. It had 3 golden hairs on the shoulder and a strong smell of soie de Paris. She went to the king in a passion and showed him this evidence clear, and swore by her distaff and wimple that she weren't having none of that beer. She said, "If I catch that young woman, she leave no more hairs on your coat. Her trying to pinch other folks' monarchs, I'll give her a swim in the moat." So the king took Rose off to the country, to an old-fashioned manor of his, with a Hampton Court maze in the garden, as she kept for occasions like this. But the queen wasn't fooled for a moment. She knew all about Henry's ways. She slipped off herself the next morning and secretly watched that there maze. She was hiding among the petunias when Rosie came out for the milk, and she fixed to her dress as she passed her the end of a bobbin of silk. Poor Rosie went back, not suspecting the trail she was leaving behind, and the queen slowly followed her, gloating at what she expected to find. The king sat there toasting a muffin and Rosie were wetting the tea, when in walked the queen, her face shining with a look of malevolent glee. She'd a basin of poison in one hand, in the other a glittering knife. The king kind of goggled a moment, then turned, said, "Rose, meet the wife." The queen shoved the basin at Rosie and held the knife out by its point. It was plain she had only two choices, the soup or to cut off the joint. The fair Rosamond begged for mercy. She said, "What you've heard is not true. Our friendship was purely platonic, a yarn which in those days was new." The king told the same tale as Rosie. "And if that's not the truth, queen," he cried, "may I die on this spot where I'm standing." As he said it, he slipped to one side. The queen at the finish believed them. But to save further messing around, she packed Rosie off to a convent and had the maze burned to the ground. The end. Well, there you are, children. Now off to bed with you. Did you like my little story? Eh? Oh, you thought it was lousy. Funny, so did I.